Good evening, and thank you for joining today's session. My name is Sapna. I'm part of the admissions team at Azim Premji University. I have my colleagues here, Sanjana Manoja, Anurag, Vrinda, Peeta. We're also from the admissions team, and they will be here with me through the session to answer your queries and to clear any doubts that you might have regarding our postgraduate programs. Right? Next. So this is our campus at Sharjapur in Bangalore, our new university campus. So it's complete now and the classes are going on, which is why we want to show it to you as the first thing, even before we start talking about the programs. So what I'm going to do today is to tell you a bit about our postgraduate programs, about the dates, about how the test is going to be like, about the, the process of selection, and then clear any of your doubts that you might have regarding the entire program, process, university, selection process, all of that, right? That is the idea of today's session. You might type in your questions in the chat box. However, wait for the session, at least part of the session, to get over, because a lot of your questions may get answered. And once a presentation gets over, we will be able to answer more of your questions. Right, so that is what the idea is. Yeah, next. Okay, so this is about the Azim Premji University. It was established in 2011 under a special act of government of Karnataka. It is set up as a fully philanthropic university, right? It is not for profit, so which means that the student fee, it doesn't go towards the revenue of the university. It is being funded by the foundation. And this is because we are trying to create competent and motivated graduates, citizens who will contribute to society. So they will study at our university. We will probably be able to inculcate some of the values that we believe in, and they will then go and contribute to a better India in the field of education, development, policy, and moving forward, we will be adding more of these. So that's the idea of the university. It's like, so it's a very vibrant place. When you come here, even for a visit, you can feel the spirit of the university, right? Next. Right, so the programs that we offer are undergraduate programs and postgraduate programs. In the undergraduate, we offer BA in economics, English, history, and philosophy, and the BSc programs and the BSc BEd programs in the same disciplines as the BSc program. And in the postgraduate programs, which is what this session is about, we offer MA in education, in development, in public policy and governance, economics, and a one-year law course, which is in law and development. Right, so these are the postgraduate programs which are currently being offered. They've been offered for the last 10 years. So we have a sizable bit of alumni, which we will talk about later. And a lot of you who are attending this session have perhaps applied for one of these programs or are in the process of applying for these programs, right? So that is the idea, that we will clear your doubts so that you can apply with all your doubts cleared. Right, next. Okay, so, the universities are universities. You come there and you sort of study for 2 years, you get a degree and you go out, right? But then what we're trying to do is we're trying to create an experience here, right? It's a unique and challenging experience. While you're at the university, you not only do classroom learning, but there's a whole lot of other activity around it, right? Which is what leads to a complete learning experience while you are at the university. Okay, and which is why we've put up this slide here, that it is a very, very unique experience. Most of our students who have passed out have said that it's very different, it's unique, it's challenging, at the same time very fulfilling. Next. Right. So our curriculum actually looks like this. We have core courses that provide the foundation for the discipline that you are in, right? So we in the first year, most of the courses that you do will be the core courses. There is a variety of electives. There's a whole bouquet of electives, for development, education, law, public policy, all of that, that you can choose. You can actually chart your career around that. You can choose your electives in the second year. Okay, and a key feature of our postgraduate programs are the field practice modules, right? So, you know, sitting in class and learning is one thing, but then actually going out there and experiencing it for yourself, as in working with the organizations or working with classes of society, with groups of people where your work is going to have an influence, that is also very important. So we facilitate that as part of the curriculum, right? And that is what we call the field practice. I'll tell you more in detail about that. And then there are open courses in other areas like art, cinema, music. And these are not extracurricular activities. These are courses that you can take and get some amount of expertise or some amount of appreciation of these courses while you are at the university through experts. Right? Next. Right. So this is the field practice that I was talking about. Okay, so you have practicums almost every week, which are basically small sort of, you know, exposures to real life problems. There are longer exposure visits, which are up to 2 weeks. There are internship opportunities, and then there are independent field projects. And these are compulsory, as in everybody has to do field projects. You can decide, you know, whether you want to do it in a small place, in a large city, with a small organization, large organization. But then, you know, this is what gives you the real feel of the discipline that you have chosen, right? So, and this is very, very important. This is what makes our program different, that we, you know, even in courses like, you know, we've all heard of science practicals, right? But even in courses like development and education, we do a lot of field work and a lot of practical work as part of the course curriculum. Right, next. Okay, so our teaching is actually, our teaching method, our teaching pedagogy, that is actually quite interesting. We, our faculty is a mix of teaching, you know, and they have teaching experience, research experience, and field experience. Okay, so what they do in class is not always like sit in class and just give boring lectures. A lot of it is, you know, experiential. A lot of it is discussion based. A lot of it is idea exchange based. In fact, now that we have a campus, we see a lot of classes happening outdoor. You know, you just like sit in a circle and then run your classes and, you know, and sort of bounce ideas off each other. A lot of it is in groups. So it's actually very interesting. It's like pretty complete in itself. It's not like, you know, 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. sort of end-to-end classes, and then which makes any studies, any academics very boring, right? And even the assessment methods are very different. You know, there are very few exams. A lot of assessment is ongoing. It is, you know, your field projects are rated, your group work is rated, you know, so a whole lot of, some of it is self-assessment. So it's sort of, you know, because we believe that postgraduate students are pretty mature and grown up, and you know, and just giving them marks at the end of the test is not the way to evaluate them, right? Okay, next. And a diversity. Now, this is also a key point of our university. We have, although we are relatively new, but, you know, we have students from all over India coming and studying here. We have students from as many as 26 states. They are from different backgrounds, right? From all, you know, from all parts of India, from all levels of society, you know, the gender mix, you know, all of that. So it's actually very, very, it's like a mini India inside our university, right? And we really value the diversity. In fact, we've built it in our admission process, so that because we want more and more, you know, students from diverse backgrounds to be there, because that is what you learn. Half of the learning happens through your peers. I mean, the teachers can teach only so much, but the peers actually sort of, you know, give you learnings that stay with you for longer. So we're very proud of the diversity. You know, again, like I said, if you come here and experience it for yourself, you will see, you know, what a lively bunch we have every year. Yeah, next. Right. And then the learning, like I said, it doesn't stop in classrooms. We have learning beyond classrooms. So we encourage our students to actually stay in the hostels. Although for postgraduate students, it's not compulsory, but we would like everybody to stay with us on campus, because that is when the learning continues, right? We also have, as part of the curriculum itself, we have guest lectures, we have conferences, right? We also have an enterprise cell where you can incubate ideas and create your own NGO. And a number of our alumni have done that already, right? And there are numerous student clubs. In fact, you know, as office bearers, we sort of lose track of how many there are. But there's constant activity on campus, right? Because, a lot of talent, a lot of interest can be demonstrated and can be actually inculcated. In fact, a lot of students who've never known music have actually managed to come here and learn music, for instance, right? And sports, theater, literary activities. So we do have, a very vibrant campus life outside the class also. Okay, next. Okay, and this is library, but that we've put it here as beyond classroom because this continues. We have books, academic and non-academic. We have one of the best libraries in Bangalore, actually. And, it's like a pretty sort of nice, lively place where you can continue your learning, either in the chosen field of expertise or other general reading also. So this contributes greatly to our learning environment. We're very proud of it. And, people from outside the Azim Premji University also are welcome to use the library. Thanks. Yeah, next. Okay, so while, like I said, we have, we encourage diversity. We understand the students come from different backgrounds and they might, in the 2 years here, the course is pretty sort of engaging and engrossing, right? And pretty taxing at times. So you need a lot of support when you're here. And, we provide that as part of, your life over here for 2 years, right? So we do provide academic support. There's students who come from, places where English has not been their medium of instruction. So we provide them English language support. We also provide quant support, actually. We run quantitative method classes for them to become adept at it so that they can follow the classes at the same rate as the peers. Right. We also have professional counseling, for students who sometimes need need a shoulder to cry on and need someone to share their fears with. So we take that very seriously, and we have a pretty well developed counseling cell on campus, available 24/7 to all our students. We also provide, medical accident and life insurance to all our students while they are with us. So as soon as you come here, regardless of whether you want it or not, or you need it or not, everybody is insured. So that is just to make sure that when you are here, you're pretty much, focused on your learning, on your experience, and not about the other, problems in life. So that's the idea. So we have very, very supportive campus. We're very inclusive campus. And these are the things that I'm saying because we get feedback on this from our own students who have passed out in the past. Right, next. Okay, so we also provide very generous financial assistance. We do not have merit-based scholarships like some of the other universities, seeing the toppers. Get a scholarship. We provide financial assistance, which is based on need, on financial need, right? So everybody who comes from with a family income of less than 7 lakhs can apply, can apply for scholarships, and we go through a separate evaluation process and look at other factors as well, and then we can give part scholarship or full scholarship. So there are different slabs, like 25% of the fee is waived, or 50% or 75%, or all of the fee is waived, right? So the fee is about 1 lakh a year. And so we can go as high as that in terms of our scholarship. And if you decide to stay in hostel, there's an additional 84,000 rupees per year. Right. And but the postgraduate students, it's not compulsory for them. So some students, a few students sometimes opt to stay out of the hostel, but most of them still end up staying in the hostel. Right. And for students who have more than 3 years of work experience, we, regardless of their income and other factors, we waive off 50% of the tuition fee. Since most of you are here and this is the early working professional round, maybe this apply to a lot of you. We draw your attention to this fact that, because we are encouraging students or professionals who have already worked, and if they want to come back and study, And, you know, the general hesitation is that why should I leave a job and come and study? So then we sort of, to take care of that, we give them, a fee waiver. That is our contribution to, their willingness to come and study with us. That is on the financial assistance. Next. Okay, accommodation. We do have hostels. We call them residences. We have them within the campus. So the new campus that I showed you the picture of, we have residences there for both boys and girls, men and women. You have to tell us at the time of admission that you want a hostel facility, and we will be happy to give it to you. It's very, very, the hostel is actually a great part of our campus, very safe. I'm saying that especially because there are a lot of women who study. In fact, the ratio currently is that there are slightly more number of women as compared to men on campus. It's very, very safe for them to come here and stay. Because it's within the campus, we have resident mentors who will stay there 24 hours. So it's very it's a nice place and it is safe. And it's pretty well equipped. It's all you saw, it's very fancy actually. You can, think about staying there, but it's not compulsory. Next. Yeah, so these are important dates for the working professional round, which is just round the corner. Right. So the last date to apply is 18th December. So if you have not as yet completed your application, this would be a good time for you to do that. Right. So if you have any doubts about the application, ask us. We will be happy to answer and complete your application so that you can write the test on the 2nd of January. Right. So this is that's the test date. And then there will be interviews following that later in the month of January and February. And the program will start in July of next year, right? So those are the dates. Next. Okay, so just in case some of you who are attending today's session do not qualify for the working professional round or for some reason miss it, you can appear for the regular round where the last date to apply will be end of February. There is the entrance test later in March, and then interviews in April and May. And the program will commence together, which is in July, right? So those are the days. So just in case you miss it, there is a regular round. But I would still advise that all of you who qualify for the working professional round, you should actually do this because this is a smaller round. It's actually, better for you to do it. That's all I would say. Next. Right, so this is how the test structure is. I would like you to look at it carefully because this year we've changed the structure a little from the previous years, right? So we have actually, although the basic format is the same in terms of comprehension, general and quantitative reasoning ability and social awareness, we have actually sort of brought it down. Those are the number of questions. They will be multiple choice questions and each question for one mark. There is no negative marking here. But in addition to the multiple choice questions, there will also be a writing ability sort of a test and that will be a descriptive type. So we will ask you a question and you will have to write a sort of a short essay, one and a half page sort of a thing. And you will be given choice of topics. So it's not anything to be worried about or scared about. You can choose and they'll be very, very diverse. So whatever your interest area is, you can still find a topic on which you can write. Right. So that is the structure of the test paper. The MA education students, they will have to write an extra test in one of these subjects, right? Because in education, you have to choose which subject you will sort of, specialize in, whether it's maths or science or social studies, language or early childhood education. So there will be a separate module for that, along with the same test. So there's no separate date, etc. for that. So when you've finished the MCQ and your descriptive type, you just start writing your subject test, right? So it's integrated. It's just that it's only for education students. And, after this, if you clear the test, then you call for interview, which is more of an interaction with the faculty members, just to judge the mutual suitability, right? Because sometimes the students also feel that this is not for them. And sometimes we feel that maybe this is not the place for them. So that is So it's not like a question answer interview saying, you know, tell me, you know, when Babur invaded India and stuff like that. So it's like it's a regular interaction. It's not question and answer. And, you know, that is just to decide the mutual suitability of each other. Because 2 years is a long time, so we should both feel comfortable for it, right? So that is what the test paper is. And right, next. Right. And so a lot of people ask that, you know, what do we do after this? You know, for postgraduate courses, actually, we have a very, very well evolved and a very, very sort of, you know, robust sort of placement system on campus. We have a placement cell, we have a placement office, we have a placement, officer, and a lot of it is run by students themselves. They cooperate, they work with us to sort of organize a placement season on campus. So all our postgraduate students, are eligible to participate in that. We invite a lot of organizations to come and participate in the campus placement process. So at the end of it, everybody does get an opportunity to work. Some students may not accept it, because they might be looking for something else. Sometimes it doesn't suit them geographically. You know, they don't like the city, they don't like the organization. But what we make sure is everybody does get one opportunity or more than one opportunity to work, okay, to earn. And, and that's working very well. So all our students, when they pass out, they are earning, right? Some of them actually find something on their own, but most of them actually participate in this process and get to. But because of the nature of the university and nature of our courses, the type of organizations that come are more in the in the social space. But that doesn't mean that they're only NGOs. There are other organizations that like to work in that space that are aware of that, you know. So we do have a variety of organizations coming to participate. And over years, we see that there is also evolving. And more organizations are showing interest in our graduates and saying that can we come and hire at the end of the year. So it's like really, and like I said, our students themselves are very active in attracting organizations to come and participate in the campus placement process, right? And of course, some of our students go abroad or within India pursue higher studies. They can pursue their PhDs, they can pursue higher studies after this, they can do some little fellowship, internships. So but the thing is that after 2 years you're definitely doing something, that is for sure. Okay, next. Okay, alumni, I mentioned this briefly. Because we've been there for 10 years, we have our alumni out there and they're very active, about 2,400 of them. Most of them are working in the social sector because that was the idea, right? And although we do not force them to work in the social sector, but out of their own choice, they choose that. But the roles that they get are quite varied, right? I mean, they can do, program management. They can specialize in some domains like public health, livelihoods, etc. And they set up their own NGOs, they set up their own social enterprise, and then they become job givers, right? And they can hire their juniors to work for them. So it's like quite good. These are some of the examples of the organizations which have been set up by our own alumni. Yeah, next. Right, so that is what it is. I think I've covered most of the general information around the postgraduate program and the admission process and the admission dates which are coming. We can take the rest of it in questions, right? We do have our contacts. So in case you're not able to ask your questions now, you can even write to us, but we can, but we'll try and see how many we can answer now, right? Yeah, so then I think the next slide is for contacts, and this is how you can. We are reasonably active on social media also, so you can actually get some of the updates there, right? So we can take up questions now. I see some of them have started coming in already. Okay. Let me read the questions. Okay. So there is a question on, are we eligible to apply if we do not qualify for the working professional round? Okay, as a rule, we don't allow that in the same year. Of course, you can apply it the next year. In the same year, we don't normally allow that because, you know, there is a, it's not, the next exam is within a month or within a month and a half. So we want to give the opportunity to the other. So we haven't, but do keep engaged with us. If there is a change in decision, we'll let you know. Okay, so at the moment, the answer is no. If you do not qualify for the working professional round, then you will have to wait for the next year. Okay. What are the documents required for financial aid? So when you apply for financial aid, actually in the form itself, you have to indicate that you will need financial aid. Then we will ask you for documents like the bank statements of your of the earning members of your family, the income tax returns, and documents of the assets you might have as a family, right? Like the fixed deposits and whether it's your own house or your rented house and stuff like that. So we do require, but the main thing is the salary certificate, the income tax returns and the bank statements. That will sort of give us the idea to start the discussion. It is all discussion based. So we will, even after having submitted the documents, we will engage in a conversation with you and then decide the level of financial aid that you're getting. Okay. Okay. The difference between the working professional course and the regular course, though the course is the same. It'll start at the same time, you'll be sitting in the same class. We're doing this round a little early. The working professional test round is we're doing this early because, the working professionals need some extra time to, give notice to their organization to prepare, to come here, right? And the students, though, khatam hua, they will, they finish the thing and then they come immediately. It's a regular business as usual for them. But the working professionals, I said, they need to give notice. They need to give sort of, 2 or 3 months notice to their organization and set their, house in order. They set their finances in order, et cetera. So that is why we are doing this, so that in case you know that you're selected, you can use the next 3 months to sort of prepare to come here. Right? That is, otherwise, it's the same course. When you're sitting in class, you're not a working professional. You're a student with us. Okay. Okay, how many seats are reserved for working professionals for PG program? Again, the same answer. No, we don't have seats reserved. Also, although we do have a conscious, unstated sort of a thing that we encourage diversity. So it's nice to have working professionals in our course, right? But there are no. So in case we don't find suitable working professionals, we're okay with going with freshers and vice versa. If you find a lot of working professionals who are very suitable and not so many freshers, so we don't follow others. We don't actually have reservation for anything. So not even for that. But we do have in our assessment, especially in the interview, there will be an element of your experience which will come in, which will be evaluated. And so maybe you will score more points. So that is the advantage that you will have as a working professional. Okay. Okay. So the syllabus for the entrance test, there are sample papers available on the, our website, and we will try and put more on that. So the first part of the test, which is the MCQ, which is English, quant and social awareness, the general and social awareness, that is, that is very generic. If you've done your 10th standard and your 12th standard and your undergraduation in any discipline, you will be able to answer those questions, right? They are at that level. They are not, there is no special preparation also required for that, right? And for the essay, also, if you're reading the newspaper, if you are taking part in, in gender discussion, social discourses, etc., you should be able to write, because it is more of an opinion and more of, what you think of this thing rather than a memory based recall. So we are really not asking when did India get independence. Okay, we might want to know why, what were the struggles we faced to get independence, right? So which is not something you learned, which is something that you have an opinion on, right? So that is the type of, so we're looking for ideas. We're looking at how competent or mature you are in carrying on a discussion And in the writing ability, we're still testing that in terms of your ability to debate a point, right? To elaborate on a point, not a memory-based test. So none of our tests are memory-based. So to say what is the syllabus is very difficult, right? If you studied in India, your 10th standard, 12th standard, even abroad, your 10th standard, 12th standard, and in undergraduation in any discipline, you will be able to clear the test. Okay? Is there an upper age limit? I'm a senior education professional, very keen on joining MA education. There is no age limit as such, since we are welcoming working professionals. But you must let us know in your application or through email, as to how senior you are. We might be able to have a discussion with you and tell you how suitable it will be for you to be a part of that cohort, right? Otherwise, actually, there isn't. Seriously speaking, they can know limit on that. But we will be able to share with you the general profile of the batch, et cetera, et cetera. If you feel comfortable, you're welcome to join. Actually, experience always helps. Okay, you can announce, I've applied for two PG programs, one in education and second in development. Will there be separate tests for both or together? Okay, so the MCQ will be, the multiple choice questions will be together. The essay will be together. For MA education, there is a separate test, right? Which is a part of the same test, a separate module. You will have to write that too. Okay, as education, the rest of the test is common. Okay, right. And I will, somebody in my team is telling me that the test this time will be online. You know, we were planning to have it pen and paper, at test centers all over India. But, we are going back and forth with this pandemic thing, with the new version coming in, et cetera, et cetera. So we've decided based on feedback and based on general, this thing, wisdom that we learned last time also, that we'll have it online. It will be remotely proctored, but you can actually give it from your homes. The interview will most probably be online too. Interviews even last year were online, and they will be you'll be informed on that accordingly. But test is online on the 2nd of Jan. Okay. Will my current salary affect my salary during placement? Is that a question? Okay. Well, you know what? That will depend on the organization that you apply to. That is not for us to say. If your current work is in a similar area, then after the course, you should actually be eligible for more, right? But if it is totally unrelated, then it's difficult to find the correlation, but it will still depend on the organization, because sometimes they look at, somebody just asked, they are a very senior professional. If they are applying for a job, obviously they will get a higher salary, right? But there's no rule like that. You're free to choose the organization you apply for, and the salary discussion is between you and the organization. The university does not influence that. Okay. Yeah, and there is a 50% tuition fee waiver for working professionals with 3 or more years of experience. So in case you have more than 3 years of experience, you get a fee waiver. Like I said, it is our way of encouraging more and more working professionals to come to take, a break from what they are doing, especially if they're not liking it, and come and get some expertise in the areas that we run our postgraduate courses in. Okay. There is another question. Can I take this? There might be many issues while taking the test online. What do we do? Okay, so we're working very closely with our test partner to try and see that these issues are avoided at our end. Now, at your end, if there are issues of connectivity and fluctuations, etc., we'll try and be as accommodative as possible. You know, I mean, if you lose like a big chunk of time, say for half an hour you were down, it really does become a challenge. But we'll see the best we can do. They will always be proctored, so there will be people available to you while you are writing the test that you can talk to, right? In fact, we are all available that time, so you can talk to us and we'll know your real problems and then we can give you the solution that time. It's difficult to say now because after all it is a test. You have to write, you're competing with others actually, so you have to take the test, but we will be very accommodative. We understand that there are places and there are days when the internet doesn't behave well and, you know, there could be. But we will run a mock test. So in the mock test, please make sure that, first of all, you attend the mock test and make sure that the devices you use and the connectivity you use are tested so that you, on that day, all these points do not come up again. So make sure that your device, your connection, the place where you will be giving the test from, all of that is tested. So this will minimize, I'm not saying it will make it zero, but it will minimize any trouble that can happen that day. Okay, Megha, you have said that there are some reading suggestions, but it's asking for an ID and password. I will check on that and I'll make it sort of free for all. There are suggested readings and we will put some suggested readings that are accessible to everyone. And the online test, yes, it is the same as the offline test, is 2 hours. The online test is 2 hours. And of course, you will get time before and after that to sort of set it up, right? So we will give you the instructions, etc., etc. Once you start writing, it is for 2 hours. And the MA education students will have an extra 45 minutes. Okay, if you've already applied for development, can you change your program now? Yes, write to us. We will try and change it. But all of you on the call, please make up your minds. Don't do too many last minute changes because it sort of challenges the system, right? And there might be last minute errors. You might not get the right question paper, etc., etc. But now, since you've brought this up, write to us. We will try and see if you can change it. Yes. Okay, Piyush, the paid internship, does it come under work experience? You will have to tell us what type of paid internship it was. Okay, normally when we say work experience, we need a work experience certificate to say that it was work experience. So we have to see how your internship was different from that, and then we can take a call on that. But you are eligible to write the exam anyway. If it is more than 2 years, yeah. But you can, yeah. Are there more questions? Okay, I see my colleagues are answering a lot of the questions. I'm hoping they are being answered, but if there is more, then please ask. Okay. When you say what are the timings of the regular session, you mean to say during the day or when will it start? It will start in July 2022, right? And if you want a semester-wise breakup, write to us separately. We will send it to you. The four terms, how are they timed, and when do you get your time off between the two, between the terms and between the years, that we will be able to write. That's a little bit of fluid thing, because like last year we started a little late because of the pandemic, right? But now we have the exact dates, we will be able to share it with you. Okay. Do APU, UG alumni apply differently? No, you just apply like a regular thing. You can, during the interview, you can mention that you are a UG alumni. Okay, during the day, our timings are pretty exhaustive. I mean, the joke is that we do 24/7. Okay, so we, if you're planning to do something else while studying, I would suggest don't do it. You know, while our classes will be only part of the day, there are other activities like projects, group discussions, out of class activity, etc., etc. So they, it's not like a regular school class where you come at 9 and go back at 3. Right, so there will be continued activity since most of the students stay on campus also, right? But if you have any particular concern, then write to us. We will be able to tell you exactly what a typical day looks like. But I'm just telling you in general, when you're here for 2 years, don't plan for any large activity outside campus. Okay, because these 2 years are all inclusive. You need to dedicate a lot of your time towards studies. Okay, so I see that most of your or almost all your questions have been answered. Do write to us. Shweta, yes, if you have failed to apply for the working professional, you can, and you are a working professional, you can still apply for regular. So everybody who had work experience and for some reason cannot apply to working professional, you can apply to regular. The regular is not exclusive only for freshers. Anybody can apply for that. Okay, yeah. So if we are done, we will close this and please feel free to write to us at admissions@apu.edu.in, right? We will try and answer all your queries and all the best for your exam. Thank you.